And you're Professor Kalnay? Is that correct? Hi, John Meister, Mr. Stegner. Okay. I'm delighted to meet you. I'm so pleased you're here.
I am so, so honored I've never stopped in a school of law. Oh, wow.
Well, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to briefly welcome everyone on behalf of the Stegner College of Law, and then I'll have Dr. Hu introduce you. So why don't we go ahead and get started. I'm Jan Nystrom, and I'm the Associate Director of the Wallace Stegner Center. And on behalf of the College of Law and the Stegner Center, I'm pleased to welcome you to today's Greenback. And this is the first Greenback of our year, and we hope you'll be able to join us for future programs. Next week, the same time, 12:15 in this room, we're going to be joined by John Cruden, and he is the Assistant Attorney General of the United States Department of Justice. And his topic will be public lands, federal environmental law, and the Department of Justice. So we hope you can join us for that. We have calendars outside you can pick up, and then we've got a much more detailed calendar with bios and other things online that you can check out. And at this point, I would like to turn the time over to Professor Pooh with the Department of Atmospheric Science, and she will introduce today's speaker. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So it is my great pleasure to introduce you Dr. Eugenia Kalnay, a distinguished university professor from University of Maryland. So Dr. Kalnay is an expert in atmospheric numeric weather prediction, predictability, modeling, weather and climate forecasting. And she was born in Argentina, but she received her high education in U.S. And she got her PhD at MIT in 1971. In fact, she was the first woman who got her PhD in atmospheric and oceanic science in MIT, so which is great. And so she's a member of National Academy of Engineering, the honorable member of the American Meteorological Society, and a fellow of American Geophysical Union and American Association for Advancement of Science. So during her career, Dr. Kalnay received numerous awards and honors around the world. So in 2009, she received the prestigious World Meteorological Organization IMO Prize, so which is the highest award the World Meteorological Society organization given to a scientist. So each year, just one winner. So she is member of the United Nations Scientific Advisor Board on Sustainability, created by the United Nations Secretary General. So her work on the impact of land use on climate change was chosen by Discover magazine as one of top 100 science results of 2010. So most notably, her seminar paper published in Bulletin of American Meteorological Society was the most cited paper in all geoscience, so with over 10,000 citations. So before her worked at University of Maryland, so she also worked at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, and also National Weather Service to lead a group who developed our nation's numeric prediction model for both weather and climate. So she was there from 1987 to 1997 to lead the country's forecast scale to be number one and two in around the world. So our regional model development is really fantastic during the time, so which is should be number one in around the world. So she is NOAA Scientific Advisor Board now. So NOAA is an agency who actually leads the efforts to make the weather and the climate in the United States. So please join me to welcome Dr. Kalnay to give a lecture today.
Thank you very much, Zhao Xia. Zhao Xia was my first student. So I'm very grateful to have such a daughter, wonderful daughter of mine. Thank you. I also would like to thank the University of Utah for the wonderful lunch that we had today. I eat low carb, and that has cured me essentially of diabetes and other problems. And I cannot believe that the food was all perfectly edible for me. It was all low carb. That's the way to go. In Maryland, they still serve cakes for eating. Okay, thank you. I also would like to say that I'm very scared because this is the first time I talk to a school of law and not. So I hope you will forgive me if I say things that maybe are not appropriate. Just in case we still have doubts, the question of is climate change really happening or is it a hoax, like it's sometimes said. The last year was the hottest year on record, and 2016 is continuing the trend, and this is the mean temperature during this period. They said they had stopped growing, but you can see that it was just temporary. So and these are some maybe I should point with this. These are trends in the temperature, and from 1850, and the sea level height and the greenhouse gases. And these are similar trends of three greenhouse gases, but over 10,000 years. And then you can see everywhere that the last part, which is shown here, is an incredible out of proportion increase, and that increases basically in the 1950s that it grows. And why is that? This is a more detailed emissions of carbon, and these are the fossil fuels and forestry, you can see that there is a change here, and that's where the Haber-Bosch nitrogen fertilization method was developed and used, and that allowed basically, as I am going to say, we are eating fossil fuels, and that allows us to grow much faster. So since the 1800s, when the Industrial Revolution started, we are burning the fossil fuels that nature accumulated over hundreds of millions of years. So in two or three centuries, we are burning what nature took hundreds of millions of years to create, and that allows us to grow like we are growing. So by burning the accumulated carbon, we emit CO2 into the atmosphere, and which acts like a blanket. This is called greenhouse effect. So the atmosphere is warming up proportionally to the total emission, which is the product of the population times the emission per person. So it's growing because both of these are growing, as we will see. This is an old population growth that I used in 2009 when I talked the first time about these things. And at that time, the estimation of the maximum population by the United Nations was 9.1 billion, and then going down. Now, in the past, basically, we have been at about 300 million or 1.3 billion, and we reached 1 billion in 1800, and then the second billion in 1927, the third billion and fourth billion, they are coming much faster than and for and they are we are supposed to get a new billion population, which happened for the first time in history in 1800. We now every about 11 or 12 years we get another billion people in the population, and this is a picture that shows that prediction of the United Nations. Then they increased it to 10 a few years later, and then the current prediction is 11 million people for the maximum, and probably it will go down. So there was a study in the London School of Economics that made use of total emission equal population times emission per person, and they made a study showing that per dollar spent, family planning reduces four times as much carbon over the next 40 years as adopting low carbon technologies. So that's an important point. So why was the population able to grow so fast since the 1950s? There are basically two reasons. There was all the sanitation and antibiotics that were created in at that time, but the most important is the use of fuels in agriculture starting in the 1950s. So we are using fuels enormously. Our agriculture is one of the main users, not only for fertilizers, but also for pesticides, irrigation, mechanization, and we call this the Green Revolution. And for example, in between 1950 and 1984, the production of grains increased by 250% because of all this addition, and the population doubled at the same time. So without fossil fuels, population would be much smaller. But now we are in a period in which we are the agriculture, at least, is not growing, it's flattening out. Industrial farming is destroying forests, soils, aquifers, and urban and suburban sprawl is overrunning the best farmland. So Herman Daly was a chief economist for a short time in the World Bank, and she felt that this is not sustainable. Then she went to the University of Maryland. She retired from the World Bank and went to Maryland. And she said, this is not sustainable. We are drawing down the stock of natural capital as if it was infinite. And that's not sustainable. So, as an example, I would like to mention North Korea. North Korea got cheap oil from the former Soviet Union until the early 1990s, and they actually were able to increase their grain production quite a lot, and then the Soviet Union collapsed, and they didn't get cheap oil. They had to pay twice as much, and they didn't have enough. They could only buy about half as much, and then the production of grains collapsed. And I used to think that the famines in North Korea were because of the horrible government that they have, and they have a horrible government, but it was actually because they didn't have access to cheap oil, and that's what happened. So in a standard neoclassical economic model, the as described by the people in the ecological economics field, the firms produce goods and service, produce household, enter the households and labor, the households produce, have labor and capital, and this is like a perpetual motion machine that always grows and grows and grows. And so they don't account for inputs, outputs, dissipation of energy, depletion, as if the world was infinite. So there are no effects on the Earth system and no limits to growth. So Herman Daly introduced ecological economics within the Earth system. And this can be schematically described as this. The human economy is not alone like in the standard economic approach. It's within the Earth system, and it needs inputs, and it produces outputs, and the outputs, which are usually garbage, need to go to sinks, and the sinks are the ocean, the atmosphere, and the land, and the sources have to keep providing the inputs. So So the in addition, once we have these outputs, the outputs produce feedbacks on nature. So the garbage produces it produces feedbacks, and the sources, the sinks also produce feedbacks on inputs and on the human economy. So we should account for these feedbacks. So the main message of my talk is of the work that we are doing is that the human system and the Earth system are coupled with feedbacks, and we should account for the feedbacks. And it's very surprising, shocking, but actually the most advanced models for studying climate change, for example, like the IPCC models and also the integrated assessment models that study the economy, they don't account for the feedbacks. And that's the main point of my talk. So, before the Industrial Revolution, we were in an empty world, so the human system was really tiny with inputs and outputs, and one could ignore the effect on the Earth system. But now we are in this situation in which the human system is almost covering, exploiting. So it went from being an empty world to being the Anthropocene after 1950, the new era determined by the humans. So population, and this slide is, every time I see it, it shocks me because it shows the population in red or pink, and it shows it from zero to 2008, and you can see that around the Industrial Revolution and especially after 1950, it's growing super exponentially, and that's the population, and the GDP per capita it's growing. It was even more constant before, and then after 1800, it grows even faster. So, what this inset figure shows the percentage of the growth of the total population, the total consumption, which is the product of the population and of the GDP per capita. It shows the percentage that is due to population, and it's about 2%, and the percentage that is due to GDP per capita, which is about 2%, if you average this. So we are growing at 4%. The consumption, the total consumption, is growing at 4% per year. So this, that means that since 1950, we double our consumption every, let's say, 20 years. So every 20 years, we consume twice as much. And the earth is not growing twice as much during those 20 years. So that's not this is the most clear picture showing that the path that we are going now is not sustainable that I have seen. So we are consuming about twice what the earth produces currently. It was estimated that of the organic biological production, like growing crops and animals, etc., the total consumption is about twice as much as the total consumption, as the total production of the earth. And the reason is that we have fossil fuels that we are also eating through this process. But we are increasing the total consumption every 20 years. This is an example of another factor, which is inequality. Inequality is very, very important because, although it's not intuitive, it increases the consumption very much so. And this is not the most impressive comparison. It compares the bottom 90% of the world population that earn less than $23 per day and the top 10% of the world population that earns more than 23%. And you can see that that's the top 10%, and it uses about half of the carbon, and the per capita footprint is about 10 times as large for the top 10%. But when you look at the comparisons that compare the rich and the super rich, it's not $23 per day, it's maybe 23 million per day. So the comparison, I'm sure you have seen them, are shocking about how the total income is distributed. This is a figure from IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, in this case they made this figure without these things, and showing how things have improved in modeling the climate in creating climate models for the past, present, and future. And when I was a student, the climate model was an atmospheric model. Then they added, for example, in the 90s, land surface and oceans. And that was the first time that we could predict El Niño. This ENSO is El Niño Southern Oscillation, which is the the largest climate phenomenon it's associated with the coupling of the ocean and the atmosphere and instabilities of that coupling system. And when we were using atmospheric models without an ocean, like here, we could not predict El Niño because you need the feedbacks to have the thing. And now we are using these models with many more components and everything, but without the human system. So we are still missing the most important component of the Earth system, which is the human system. And it's impossible to predict what will happen in the future, even in 20, 50 years, if we don't have the feedbacks, in the same way that we cannot predict El Niño without coupling the atmosphere and the ocean with feedbacks. So we developed what we feel is an Earth system, human system feedback should be included. And It's very comprehensive, and it's not so complicated. It's perfectly feasible, and we are publishing now a paper where we say this is how we should do it, at least to include all the feedbacks. So it has a human system, an earth system, and it has a population demographic included, and very importantly, it has policies, because the only way that we can survive and not collapse like many previous civilizations is to have policies that are aware of what will happen if we continue the way we are. And I'll give you a very nice example, which was so amazing for me. This doesn't look like that, but it's South America, southern South America. So this is the Atlantic and the Pacific, and this is Chile, and this is Argentina, my home country, and Julia's home country. And what we are showing is the vegetation index measured by satellite. It's called NDVI. And red means that it's basically saturated. So there is a small province in Argentina that actually follows policies of forest sustainability. So they exploit the forest, but they've taken measures to sustain it. And you can see that this very similar other areas that should all be red, they are basically horribly exploited. So policies, even in a small province, in a country, is important. And what happens if we continue like we are now? I would like to ask the question, could an advanced society like ours collapse if we continue like we are? And then collapses of many advanced societies have taken place in the last 500 years, hundreds of advanced societies. And a recent study of the many collapses that took place in about 4,000 years ago, or 5,000 years ago to 10,000 years ago, has said that we can see that there were collapses, and they say it wasn't climate forcing, it wasn't war, it was not disease that produced that collapses. So it concluded that the collapses were due to the population and consumption overrunning the current capacity, which is the amount of population that the nature can sustain. So we developed to study this a model which is called human and nature dynamical model. So we call it HANDI for human nature dynamic. And to start understanding the nonlinear feedbacks between the Earth and the human system. And first, let me mention that there were many cases of dynamics that produced historical cycles of rise, growth, prosperity, and then collapse. In nature, those are common. And for example, these are basically rabbits and foxes in Canada. And you can see that when the rabbit's population, for example, grows a lot, then the fox's population also grow a lot, and then they consume the rabbits, and then the rabbit population falls, and then the fox's population falls. And this is a well-known predator and prey model that has these paired oscillations. So it's called, do these things occur in human system? Generally, I'm sure that every young person here believes that the human history has been a continuous and inevitable upward trend in levels of population and prosperity, and we can continue going like that. Now, I shouldn't say, I'm sure, the younger people are actually more aware, I think, than the middle-aged people and older people. So the historical record is not that there has been a continuous growth in population and prosperity. The historical record is closer to these oscillations found in nature. Cycles of rise and collapse occur frequently in history, involving centuries of decline, population, economic, and intellectual. So I'll just give a list of some very famous historical collapses. The Roman Empire collapsed, the Minoan civilization. The Mycenaean civilization was amazing because I didn't even know it existed, but it preceded the Greek civilization. It was 2000 before Christ. And the when they collapsed, the population dropped by an order of magnitude. The urban areas were abandoned. The literacy was completely lost. And the recovery took 400 to 500 years to recover. And there were history is full of cycles of rise and decline. Mesopotamian history, the Egyptian history, they had three very famous declines and growth and collapse. The Chinese history, the Indian history. Well, we never studied these things, but that's what happened. And also in the New World, the Maya civilization disappeared completely. So that when the Spanish, they collapsed, they were very, very, very advanced. But when they collapsed, they disappeared so much that when the Spanish went through that part of the Yucatan, they thought that there were interesting little hills, and they were just cities that had been completely covered by nature. So the list goes on in the Andes, and in the U.S., the Mississippi Valley, the Southwest, all these are. So, and also, these are the ones that I mentioned before when with the introduction of agriculture into Europe, it was many growths and collapse. And this is shown here, the Neolithic population from 10,000 to 4,000 in all of Western Europe. And you can see that they grew and then collapsed, and they grew and they collapsed. And each of these takes about 500 years. And in the European medieval demography, there was an incredible collapse known as like the Black Death, where the rats spread its pest. And people say it was due to the rats, but the rats were there all the time. It's because they were weakened by all sorts of problems that they collapsed. So the Chinese population also had peaks separating and then collapses, separating dynasties. So, in summary, the cycles of rise and collapse are common among different regions, time periods, and levels of technological development. And these are two citations that say that. So, we developed this human and nature dynamical model, which we call Handy model, and if you are interested, you can Google Handy model and you can download it because I think it's quite interesting. So we started with a standard predator and prey model, but then we added two properties that are found in human populations. One is the ability to accumulate surplus or wealth. And that only happened after the introduction of agriculture, because before agriculture, when they were we were hunters and gatherers, we couldn't like save a lion for the next year or something like that. So, or a cow or something. Wealth started with agriculture. And then we added an economic inequality, which, as I mentioned, is very important. It has a tremendous impact on the distribution of the consumption. And so we investigated the mechanisms. And this is the description of the equations, and I'm going to skip it, but there are basically, we introduced in the population two classes, the elites and commoners, and which means the rich and the poor. So the total population is the rich and plus the poor, and then we have an equation for nature which regrows or regenerates, and then it is depleted by the production where only the commoners produce. And the wealth is managed by the elites, so the elites make kappa times more than the poor, like we put 100. So then we have an equation, and also both the poor and the rich die at death rates alpha C, and birth rates they grow by birth rates beta C, and same with the, and we put the same coefficients for both, except that when there was a famine or they ran out, there was not enough food, the rate of death increased from a healthy level, like dying in your 70s or 80s, to a famine level where you die very quickly. And the elite, the poor, were like this as wealth decreased, and the rich had the wealth to help them until they ran out of wealth, and then they also died faster. So this describes the model. And so this is a result when we have an egalitarian society where everybody makes the same. Kappa, the difference between the salary for the rich and for the poor is one. And then if we also deplete in an optimal way, we get the best solution, which is a steady state at the high population and a very high wealth, and nature is optimal because it's between zero and the saturation value. So if we increase the depletion per capita, the depletion per capita, this is optimal, and if we decrease the carrying capacity, which is the population that can be carried, decreases, but it reaches still equilibrium, so people are not dying all over. But if you increase the depletion, there are cycles of prosperity and collapse. And if you increase the depletion, the use of nature even more, then it collapses because nature doesn't regrow anymore. What happens if we include inequality? So we use optimal depletion, which is very good, but with a k equal to 100. So the rich the elites make 100 times more per capita than the poor. So the elites are shown as very, they start as very few, and until about 500 years, the two solutions are the same because the elites are not influencing. So after this, what happens? Well, what happens is that the elites, which are plotted here in their equivalent value, so they are multiplied by 100, which is the consumption, the elites keep growing. And that's what happened in the historic collapses that have been seen. There is an overgrowth of the elites, and the elites grow and collapse. And the commoners collapse before them, but they still collapse. And so if we have both inequality and high depletion, then the system collapses even in 500 years, which is typical of what has been observed. And it's interesting because, for example, at this time the wealth is decreasing, and the commoners are starting not to have enough to eat, so they die of famine. But the elites think, oh, we are doing great, we can continue, and eventually they collapse. So, there is a hope, because if we reduce the depletion per capita and the inequality and slow down the population growth, it's possible to reach a steady state where everybody is well and survive well. And reaching this equilibrium requires changes in policies, reduce the depletion per capita, reduce the inequality. Daily estimated that the inequality should not be larger than 10, and that's more or less what we got. Using 10, we got sustainability, and also reduce the birth rate to reduce the growth. And this is the last example that I'm going to show, which is perhaps the most shocking. What will happen if we have this collapse with inequality and over depletion? But we find like mankind did in the 17 or 1800s, large stocks of non-renewable energy, which is fossil fuels. So here in the model that we did, we were using nature as regenerating, like crops or animals, husbandry or fisheries or forests. They all regenerate and can be used year after year. But now we add to this regenerating nature fossil fuels. So what happens? And what happens is the following. Without the fossil fuels, the collapse takes place at 500 years. With the fossil fuels, there is still a collapse, but it takes a place in 700. So it postpones the collapse by 200 years. But what's amazing is that the population increases by a large factor of about 20. So this is very reminiscent to what happened with the figures that I showed you before, what happened after the Industrial Revolution. The population just grew like crazy, and this is what happens in the model when we introduce non-renewable fossil fuels. So, again, the fossil fuels are allowing us to grow 2% every year with the population and with the consumption per capita, except that it's much more unequal than shown here. So, fossil fuels are stocks of energy and material resources accumulated over several hundred million years, and we are consuming them in 3 centuries. And it's really bad, because a similar dynamic is taking place with aquifer water. Aquifer water is fossil water that was accumulated over hundreds or thousands of years. And in just a few decades, we are drawing down vast stores of fresh water from aquifers that take centuries or millennia to recharge. And then we can see that the fracking industry puts down very low in Oklahoma the dirty water, and Oklahoma has gone from having no earthquakes to having more earthquakes than California. So we saw that the collapse is postponed by 200 years. Sorry. Right. And can we survive it? Yes, but we have to take policies that allow us to live sustainably. And I think I will finish a little bit early so we can, you shouldn't escape, but ask questions. And so we are using up in 200 years the fossil fuels that nature accumulated over millions of years. And same with fossil water, and same with soil. Soil is another treasure that we are reducing as if it was free. The use of fossil fuels for agriculture increased food production after 1850. So we did this model handy, and we call it handy one because we are doing follow-up models for experiments which we call thought experiments. They are not real experiments because obviously it's not a realistic model, but they answer the question, what if we do this or what if we do that? And we see that social inequality and population growth and high depletion per capita lead to collapse policies that reduce partially this, like social inequality and population growth and depletion per capita, allow society to become sustainable, and it's not a big sacrifice. And now we are we did also handy two, where we added the non-renewables that increased. And what happens is that within 200 years, the population increases by 20 times, and it postpones collapse by 200 or 300 years. And if the transition from fossil to renewables, which are solar and wind, is done early enough, it is completely possible to avoid this collapse associated with a higher, 20 times higher population. So, I want to notice that we are not currently modeling the coupled Earth human system, either the IPCC models or the integrated assessment economic models. They get their population from the United Nations, and the United Nations they do their best, but they cannot estimate the population, the growth of the population, and for example, they are increasing the maximum almost every 2 years. And for example, one thing that they project for the next 50 years is that emigration from poor countries is going to go to zero. And they say, we didn't know, it's so difficult to determine what the emigration is going to be, so we just had to make this assumption. But the assumption is obviously wrong, and if they had a model that couples poor countries and rich countries and the resources, that you can make at least a model simulation that is reasonable, not goes to zero. So, and also, I work on data simulation, as Xia mentioned, and it could be used also for the couple models. So I just this is my last slide. I wanted to mention that if you Google handy model, you can download it, and it's really interesting. It was published in 2014 in the Journal of Ecological Economics, and every month it continues to be the most downloaded paper they ever had. And before its publication, it was discussed by a blogger in the Guardian of London, and it was a very good discussion. And this blog had 40 million hits, so it touches many people. And the other thing is, we are having a new paper coming, we have many co-authors that are very famous, like Mark Kane, who developed the first coupled ocean atmosphere model to predict El Niño, and many others. And it's called Modeling Sustainability, Population Inequality and Consumption and Bidirectional Coupling of the Earth and Human Systems, which is what I thought. So it's also going to be open access. So thank you very much for your patience. Let me give you the... Sorry.
Not only I enjoyed it very much, but I thought it was an outstanding contribution to the field. And considering what you quote here, I was very surprised to see that at the end, NASA had decided to put a disclaimer on your work. And knowing that you had been very well supported and you were one of the favorite daughters of NASA, I wonder if you would dare to comment why they would do such injustice.
Yeah. The blogger wrote a blog in the Guardian of London, and in order to attract attention, said, NASA says that, and attributed our conclusions to NASA. So that produced a lot of... But actually, NASA responded very nicely, and I decided to put the resolution in the paper, because they said we supported this paper because they paid Safa Moteshari, the first author, a graduate student assistantship, but that doesn't mean that we agree with the conclusions or not. We never look at it. We just supported it. So it was, but that helped a lot to publicize it. Yeah. So thank you for that question. Yeah.
Good afternoon. My name is Jerry Lynch. I'm a University of Utah law student here. I'm originally from Maryland, so thanks for coming all this way. My question, as it relates to health law, which is my main area of study here, is it's interesting to see how the two, environmental law and health law, connect. And I was wondering, based on your first slide, if you have any kind of viable bioethical solutions for enacting sort of new procedures for reproductive law as it relates to sustaining the environment.
Yeah, I think there is one method that works incredibly well and has been used in several countries, which is education of women. It's incredible. In Brazil, they reduced from being among the high babies per mother to 1.7, which was the same as China when you did the one-child family. And what they did, apparently one of the most successful things that they did is that they had a very popular soap opera that had women that were attractive and intelligent and had a few children and were very successful, and that just changed the attitude. And the other thing is, both the government in Brazil and the former government in Argentina, for example, they provided a little bit of funding for women that send their children to school, and so that reduced the exploitation of children working and going increasing education. That, but it's very important to have another fantastic example is Mexico. In the 1970s, they decided that the way they were growing, they were going to collapse. It's amazing that they took that decision, and they made an incredible advertisement campaign throughout the country. Everywhere it was plastered with papers that said, "Few children allows us to give us what they need, to give them what they need, and small families grow better," and all sorts of things like that. And my Mexican friend that told me all these things told me that in order to get married, they had to learn how to practice birth control. And Mexico too, it went from, I think Brazil was at 5 and Mexico was at 7 babies per woman, and Brazil went to 1.7 and Mexico to 2.2 in the 2010. So education, I think, is essential. It doesn't need to be coercive, and it certainly shouldn't be violent. Sorry, I had not seen this.
I'm Hansi Eber, Professor Emeritus of Economics, and the IPCC agrees that it is possible to avoid collapse, but the requirements to avoid collapse seem to be much more stringent. They say we have to peak with fossil fuels with emissions in the next 5 years and then go down by 2050, and there is not really time to build everything renewable, so we have to make huge transformations in society and in economy before it really becomes apparent that we are in such a big disaster. And I don't see this in your model, and I wonder, I've been looking around why it's not. Maybe because in your equation 3 you have nature regenerating at a very robust rate, which is not really the case. So,
yeah, the model that we have is a four-variable model: the rich, the poor, nature, and accumulated wealth. So we cannot represent the IPCC conclusions with that type of model. But I agree with the IPCC. The part of, we were talking about what has to be done about the, and that's a long-term process. For example, if there were 2 or less children per woman, then in a century we would be closer to the optimal carrying capacity, which is about 1 billion, according to some people. So that's a long-term thing. But the IPCC is talking about the garbage that we send to the atmosphere and the ocean, and that is changing the characteristics of the temperature to which the rest of the inhabitants of the Earth have gotten used to. So we are, for example, the ocean is becoming more and more acidic, and that's killing the coral reefs. So that's if we want to keep the plants and the animals the way we want them, we have to act quickly. I don't think there is a contradiction. Yeah.
One of your last slides showed a second version of your model with renewable resources that a sustainable population would be about 20 times that, which is a major difference, and I'm wondering what numbers you consider sustainable. And you just mentioned a billion. 20 billion would be still a question of how do you feed those people?
Where does the food and water, where does the land and the water come from, not to mention the energy, even if you have the energy?
Yeah, my personal feeling is that we are already over the maximum, and we are surviving well and growing economically still because we are using fossil fuels. But that's a temporary, and as our solution shows, eventually it runs out and we will collapse faster with 20 billion. It's not clear. I think we could completely replace fossil fuels with renewables, solar and wind, and that could be done if the governments decided not to give money to the oil companies and instead invested more in the renewables. So that would certainly answer the question that the gentleman there would do it. If we, in the Sahara alone, we did an experiment where putting windmills and solar panels and covering the Sahara produced enough energy to cover all the energy needs in the world. Of course, you have to transport and do things, but it's not an impossible. It's not as if we need to continue using the fossil fuels to survive. We could replace them, and I think that we would be better off with slowly reducing the population with non-coercive methods to a more sustainable level. And it's not clear whether it's 1 billion or 2 billion or 3 billion, but it's certainly not 11 billion, which is what we are heading now.
Mine is short. With a reduction in population and utilizing fossil fuels for sustainable food production, what is the maximum population? Fossil fuels are a limited non-renewable resource. The earth can only produce so much food without
running out.
So based on that, what's our population ideal?
Well, we are going to run out of fossil fuels, so it would be zero.
Not the fossil fuel question, the population question.
Yeah, the population question will continue increasing until...
trying to manage everything, assuming that we cannot use fossil fuel, how much food can the earth produce to sustain X number of people?
I don't know. To answer that question, which is complex, I think we need more complete models than this preliminary, like this one. And this one would allow us to say what happens if we continue running out of soil and all other questions that we are not even thinking about that. Thank you.
Return. Testing 1, 2, 3. There are two propositions that I think the leadership of the environmental movement worldwide is considering right now. What I consider to be leadership is the cutting edge. One, and I'm curious to know how you, based on everything you know from working at NASA, doing all these projections, what your opinion of these two propositions are. One proposition is that if we think that renewable, so-called clean renewable energy is a solution, it's not. Because even although some people are predicting that we can, the market forces by themselves will push clean renewable energy, meaning solar and wind, both for energy and transportation, to fruition in the U.S. for market dominance by 2030, that's 14 years from now, purely market forces already in play. But other people say to take that as a solution is a placebo, because we have all of the other depletion and resource depletion and pollution problems over and above those. And furthermore, the consequences of greenhouse gas effect are already baked in. So they believe these are called the collapse-nicks. You may have heard that term. They believe that collapse is inevitable and is already baked in. And James Hansen may be one of them, if we ask him privately. So I'm wondering what you think about the idea that irreversible global warming tipping points are already baked in, number one. And number two, leaving all that aside, there are people in the leadership, the cutting edge of the environmental movement, that are now saying we should hasten collapse, civilizational collapse, because only by hastening it can we bring it down quickly enough to prevent it from killing biodiversity and the biosphere. So those are the two propositions. Your views.
Gosh, you are very depressing, but what you are saying makes sense. But with respect to the first one, fossil fuels are the source of our path, and that's leading to collapse. So why not reduce it to much less if we can do it? At least that part will not get much worse like it's getting now. It's every year it's growing, but we can at least avoid the growing and maybe start the decrease, and at least it will be partially. If I had cancer, I would like a placebo that partially corrects the problem. The second question is whether we are already doomed and we should have the collapse early. It's an interesting point. I'm not going to see it because I'm a old person, but it's actually, I wouldn't repeat your words because people would consider me exaggerated, but maybe you are right.
What has been the impact of the one-child policy in China?
They have 300 million Chinese people that were not born. So if they had not followed that policy, they would have the population of the United States added to what they have. And every year we add 84 million people, which is the population of Germany. So every year we add one Germany to the whole population. But it had a tremendous impact. And it doesn't look like that because the time scales are like 25 years for one generation. But instead of going like that, it went like that and it's starting to go down. And they were so criticized for their lack of human rights, as if a woman that is forced to have 8 children has the human right to have those eight children. Well, my mother had eight children. I was number seven out of eight, but I think that what the Chinese people did was the right thing to do. Who needs another whole United States in China? No.
I'm just going to ask
sorry.
Just a general question.
Sorry.
Their population control or reducing population growth is a topic that's resisted by many religions, and yet it is in one of your first slides it said, you know, we can accomplish more with reduced population than all our technology changes by four times. How can we make that that paradigm change?
What I said was the reduction of carbon per dollar spent in that it is better spent in population than in carbon reduction because it's a very efficient way to reduce the population. What was your question?
Do you have any suggestions on how to make that paradigm change?
Yeah, I think education, and I am so grateful that today I'm going to give two talks in the University of Utah. Thank you very much for inviting me. I think we should all talk about this. Population is a taboo subject. I was once in an NRC meeting on climate change in the middle 80s or 90s, beginning of 90s, and we talked about this and that, and I said, what about population? Oh, that problem is already solved. It's already coming down. Because during that time, I remember Bush father cut all the support for family planning for third world countries, and we've been accusing China of. My son, actually, one of his girlfriends was a nurse, and she was working in Minneapolis in a place where there were many immigrants, and a woman asked her, how come you don't have children? And she said, well, I haven't felt yet the want to have, I'm married, but I'm waiting. And the woman said, gosh, I wish I had your ability to make that decision. In my case, I have six children, and I have nothing to say about how many more we'll have. And that's what the real human rights for women that in most of the world. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much for presenting so perfectly. And thank you for the low carb lunch. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.